Very good morning, students. This is a course on analog electronics, and it is a core course in electronic circuits, which is taught to the students who are pursuing an undergraduate program or a postgraduate degree program in electrical and electronics engineering. And this course also proves useful to engineers and other professionals who wish to upgrade their knowledge through self-study. So the main objective of this course is to analyze and design electronic circuits, both for analog as well as digital applications, and also for discrete and integrated circuits. While the application of integrated circuit is extensively covered, and emphasis is placed on the transistor circuit design, and this is done because of the belief that even if majority of the students who are studying this course may not pursue their career in IC design, or they may get interested through this course and they may pursue their career in the field of physical design also. Okay, and knowledge of what is inside, if they do not pursue, but still they will have a knowledge of what is inside the IC package, and how would it enable intelligent and innovative applications of such as chip. Okay, and also furthermore, the advances in VLSI technology and design methodologies will also be understood, and IC design itself has become accessible on an increasing number of engineers, right? And the prerequisite for studying this course is that you will have to have a thorough review of some linear circuit materials, which is and then you need to have a review on the two port network parameters and the network theorems and single time constant circuits, and the S domain analysis is required, and also a number of relevant circuit analysis problems also you need to have a review on. Have a thorough review on these, which you have studied in your syllabus in the third semester. Okay, and all that is required is the semiconductor device physics. The main focus, and also a description of the IC packaging, okay, you will also, or high IC fabrication can also be realized. So let's begin our course. So as I said, the course is on analog electronics, and we are discussing the module one. I'm Professor, let me introduce myself. I'm Professor Poonima from the Department of Electronics and Communication Engineering from the BMS College of Engineering. And I will be handling the sessions on the first module of the course, which is exclusively on BJT biasing, okay, BJT and as well as MOSFET biasing. Okay, so this is the first session or the first lecture of the course. So the content of the module one, or the course content for module one, is we have BJT biasing in BJT amplifier circuits, and we'll also get introduced into the small signal operations and modules. And then we have, as the second part of module one, we'll focus our discussion on MOSFETs. where we will get an introduction through for the biasing in MOSFET amplifier circuits and small signal operations and modeling. So this is the detailed syllabus for module one, where in BJT biasing, biasing in BJT amplifier circuits is discussed. And in detail, we will be focusing on different biasing approach for BJT and biasing using a collector to base feedback resistor. And we will also, in small signal operations and modules, we will discuss on collector current and transconductance, base current and input resistance, emitter current and input resistance, voltage gain, separating the signal and DC quantities, and also we will discuss on hybrid pi model. And for MOSFET biasing and MOS amplifier circuits, we will again discuss the different approaches for MOSFET biasing, like fixing the VGS, fixing VG, drain to gate feedback resistors, and for small signal operations and modeling in MOSFET, the DC bias point is discussed, signal current in drain, voltage gain, small signal equivalent circuit module, and transconductance is also discussed. Okay, and the prescribed textbook for the course is Microelectronic Circuits, Theory and Application by Adal Siddhar, Kenneth Smith, which is the sixth edition from Oxford publisher. And then we have the second textbook, the prescribed textbook is the Operational Amplifiers and Linear Integrated Circuits by Ramakant Gayakwad, which is the fourth edition from Pearson's Education. And then we have three reference books that are also given, which is Electronic Devices and Circuit Theory by Robert L. Boylestad and Louis Nesselsky, which is the 11th edition Pearson's Education. And then we have the second reference book textbook as The Fundamentals of Microelectronics by Behzad Rezavi, which is the second edition John Wiley publication. And then we have Milman and Halkias, the book on integrated electronics, which is the second edition, and also from Tata Magral publishers. Okay, so these are the textbooks and reference textbooks that are that are prescribed for your syllabus. And majority of the course content that we will be discussing is also referred through or in line with the discussions that has happened in these prescribed textbooks and reference books. And we have set three learning objectives for the session one of the module one. So basically, we have divided the module one into roughly 8 or 9 sessions. So this is the first session, and in the first session, we will the learning objective set is, or what you will be able to learn in this particular lecture one or the session one, is why analog circuit design is required or is important, and what are the different parameters one has to consider for the design of analog electronics is being discussed. And then we will also introduce you to the transistors. Of course, you might have a brief idea about transistor and diodes in your with the foundation that you have in the basic courses in the first year as well as in the third semester. So you will have an introduction to the transistor, and also we will see the different semiconductor devices and what technologies are used for these semiconductor devices. This is the first slide, and if you observe this slide, so you see what you see in the slide is some of the present day popular electronic products, right? And think of the gear you can't live without. Okay, say for example, the smartphones you constantly keep checking, right? And the cameras that go with you on every vacation, and the TVs serves as a portal to binge watch and as well as gaming, right? And each owns its own influence to one model that changed the course of technology for good, right? So As you all know, or as you belong to the electrical cluster or the electronic cluster, okay? So electronics is a branch of physics and technology that deals with circuits, transistors, microchips, and the behavior and movement of electrons. It handles electric circuit containing both active and passive elements and uses the underlying techniques. So technologies are growing at a very fast rate in the world, and it is important for technology enthusiasts to pace up with the latest changes in the society. Electronic devices have become an important part of our day-to-day life. Okay, so if you see all this in the item or the pictures seen in the slide, okay, so you, so I am sure that most of it everybody will have at your residences, right? And electronic and technologies are growing at a very fast rate in the world, and it is important for we technology enthusiasts to pace up with the latest changes in the society. And electronic devices have become an important part of our day-to-day life. And it has become difficult for us to do work without using the electronic device. So we live in a generation that uses electronics and technology where, so you see nowadays the robots and artificial intelligence, which are capable of doing the human work, right, with more ease and efficiency. So electronics is our daily life are made up of, or electronics in our daily life are made up of active and passive elements. And again, it is available in a very small circuitries, right? Or we are dealing with smaller integrated circuits. So the ICs, the transistors, the diodes are made up of, we are talking about the integrated circuits, we are talking about the transistors, we are talking about the diodes. So these are all made up of the semiconductor materials which work when current flows through them, right? So common people are highly benefited. Okay, so if you observe the picture here, you can see the Android mobile phone, you are seeing the television, you are seeing the home utensils, all the products that are used at your for the consumers. Okay, you see the wristwatches, you see the ATM machines, you see the laptops, you are seeing smart lighting systems. Okay, so common people are highly benefited by this industry. So consumer electronics are the electric devices meant for everyday use. So when I say consumer electronics, they can be categorized into office gadgets, or it can be home appliances, audio and video systems, advanced consumer devices, okay, or even the storage devices. And when I say office devices, it includes the calculator, the scanners, the printers, the fax machines, and the front projectors. And when we say home appliances, I'm sure everybody would know what. So you have the refrigerators, you have the air conditioners, you have the washing machines, you have the vacuum cleaners, microwave ovens, right? And then for audio and video systems, you may have the headphones, like you can see right away I'm wearing the headphone, right? The headphones, the DVD players, the VCRs, the microphones, the color televisions, loudspeakers, video game consoles, right? And then you have the advanced consumer devices like the set-top boxes, dishwashers, ATM, PDA, smartphones, barcode scanners, PA, storage devices like the DVD, HDD, then you have the MP3 players, memory cards, joke box, and then so when we observe all this, this industry basically is focusing on making real-time automation, right? And this includes industrial automation and motion control motor drive control, machine learning, robotics, mechatronics, power converting technology, renewable energy applications, photovoltaic systems, power electronics, and biomechanics. Okay, and also we are moving on to a world where everything is getting smarter day by day, right? We have the smart grid system, where smart electric system take information from communication technology and work accordingly based on the desired power consumption. So it is an application of the artificial intelligence, computing, network, electric system, smart meters are again the best example for a smart grid system. So the feature for a smart grid system is they are based on two-way communication and they have interactive sensors. And they are self-monitored and you can also debug them. And electricity is diversely it is distributed validly, right? So the focus is on energy efficient systems. And then when we think of industrial automation and motor control, machines have increased the productivity and efficiency, and hence you are saving upon the time and on the cost. And machines are also, they save the unmanageable work, right? And that's why the delegation of human automation has become a preferable choice in industry. Okay, so again, in the field of image processing, we have the 3D images have been evolved for multiple 2D images, and algorithms have been developed to extract the 3D information from the 2D patterns, right? And then we have we are also seeing the presence of electronics in medical applications. So advanced medical instruments are being developed for data recording, for physiological analysis, and they are mainly used to diagnose diseases and other healing purposes. So when we think of daily use of electronic devices, we come across mobile phones, iPods, iPads, and tablets. So when mobile phones and cellular phones were introduced to the public for the first time with the main purpose of immediate communication, this technology usually gained popularity and demand. The iPod and the tablets are again following the same pattern for the people, right? The internet is one of the greatest breakthrough in technology of our generation. It is the only thing by which the transfer of data from the server to the computer and from computer to the server was possible. And this is why you can send messages, documents, and files on your Facebook, WhatsApp, and Instagram accounts. Okay, and in this from past 1.5 year, we are facing the pandemic situation, and everybody are able to get connected. Okay, though we are under a defined lockdown, we are able to get connected with each other only because of the Wi-Fi and the internet, right? And then again, you have the traditional devices like the cassette tapes, which are used only to contain few number of songs. And nowadays, they have been replaced by MP3 and MP4 smartphones and iPods, which are capable of storing thousands of songs, and they even play the songs much more smoothly. And the camera is again a significant device, as it really preserves the unforgettable memories in a frame. And smartphones and iPad and mobile tablets and other devices are also equipped with cameras to capture photos and shoot videos. So presently all major smartphones and especially the branded ones are competing with each other to provide the best camera and image quality of highest resolution. And if you see, even in the food industry, electronics or devices have in daily life have seen a major sector in food function. Modern machines produce food in high quality every day, right? Every day. So you see the electronics playing its role in every in all possible areas and in all possible areas of our day areas in our day to day life. Okay, so if you observe all this, we are living in an era of VLSI. Okay, so VLSI, I'm sure you know the expansion. It's very large scale integration. Okay, so when you think of the old days, say about 40 years ago, the number of transistors found in a chip was even was the number of transistors found in a chip was even at its highest count, less than say 10,000. Take say for example the once popular Motorola 6800 series microprocessor developed in mid 1970s, fabricated based on 6 micrometer feature size, and the size of 6800 consisted of merely 4100 transistors in it. And nowadays the number of transistors in a very large scale integration, or we also refer it to as the super large scale integration, okay, SLI technology or a chip, may possibly reach up to 10 billion, okay, with a feature size smaller than 15 nanometer. Okay, imagine now we are dealing with nanometer sizes. Okay, and there is a little doubt that the electronic world has experienced a significant advancement for the past 50 years or so. And this to a large extent is due to the rapid technology improvement in the performance, the power, area, cost, time to market of the integrated circuit chip. So to distinguish the increase of transistors in every 10 year, each era is designated a name. And I'm sure you're familiar with these four names. Okay, you have the SSI, okay, SSI, that means the small scale integration, which in the year 1950, where the number of transistors in a chip was less than 100. And then later, 10 years later, that is say in 1960, we had the medium scale integration, where the number of transistors on a chip or in a chip was anywhere between 100 and 1000. And then we have say the large scale integration, okay, in the year 1970, between so where the number of transistors in the chip was anywhere between 1000 and 10,000. And then we have the very large scale integration in 1980, where the number of transistors on a single chip where was from 10,000 to, you could accommodate from 10,000 to 1 lakh transistors could be accommodated. Okay, and then we have in 1990, we have the integration level moved on to ultra large scale integration, okay, where the number of transistors or placement of transistors on a single chip increased from 1 lakh to 10 lakh number, okay. And then not even 10 lakh, 100 lakh numbers, okay. And then we have the super large scale integration in the year 2000, okay, where more than 100 lakh transistors could be placed. So scaling the VLSI technology faces multiple challenges, including power dissipation, leakage management, short channel effects in deep submicron transistors, increasing capacitive and inductive noise in interconnect and the platform integration issues. And CMOS has become the prevailing technology due to its high speed and package density coupled with low power consumption. So new technologies have emerged to further increase circuit speed and to reduce the design and technology constraint. So some of the examples of the technology used are, you have the CMOS, and then you have the BiCMOS, which is nothing but the bipolar complementary MOSFETs or MOS technology. And again, you have the CMOS in silicon on insulator, okay? So these are some of the technologies available. And again, we need to deal with the technology challenges that they offer, okay. And our one is that we are dealing with VLSI or the VLSI circuits and their technology, and at the other hand, we have the market demand for the wireless systems, optical systems, sensor systems, high-speed microprocessor, high-speed memory, and again, these systems should consume less power. Okay, and they have to be highly sensitive, and again, they should offer low noise, or they should be tolerant towards noise. Okay, the IO devices should be tolerant. And if you observe all this, the power and speed are again a major. Okay, when you're dealing with wireless systems and optical systems and sensor system, power and speed are again a major challenge that one needs to face. Okay. Let's first understand. We are discussing a course on analog electronics, and so we should first understand why it is important to know about analog electronics in an era of digital communication and digital electronics. Okay, we saw all smart systems. Okay, where we are. We are living in an era of digital communication and digital circuits, and why is analog circuit very important for us to know, or why the discussion of, or why this has to be a part of your syllabus. Okay, so analog circuits basically represent the key component of communication and other systems in widespread. So it is again growing commercial use. So high-speed transistors are essential to the operation of such circuits, and analog and digital circuits are used to transmit and process the information, like the sound, light, from an environment to generate continuous variable signals. So analog circuits can route the signal directly, whereas digital circuits can change digital circuits are used. The digital circuits can change the analog signal by evaluating them at regular interval and giving out the resulting values. So to get the output, analog circuits can directly give the signal, while a digital circuit giving out resulting values. So to get the output, analog circuits can directly give the signal, while a digital circuit has to change the information back to analog signal. So the working of an analog circuit can be done with normal waveform for converting, storing, and amplifying the signal, while a digital circuit alters the waveform into pulse signal. Analog or the linear circuits, okay? So if you see, the first difference between a digital circuit and an analog circuit is digitals are highly linear, non-linear, whereas analog circuits are highly linear, okay? Analog or linear circuits typically use only a few component, or thus some of the simplest types of ICs. Generally, analog circuits are connected to the devices that collect signals from the environment or send signals back to the environment. Say, for example, a microphone, okay, it converts the factual vocal sound into an electrical signal of varying voltage, okay? The analog circuit then modifies, okay? So it modifies the signal in some useful way, such as amplifying it, or say filtering if there is some undesired noise. So such a signal might then be fed up, or it may be fed back to a loudspeaker, which would reduce the tone originally picked up by the microphone. So another typical use for analog circuit is to control some devices in response to the continuous change in environment. For example, a temperature sensor sends a varying signal to a thermostat, which can be programmed to turn an air conditioner or a heater, or it can be even the oven on off. Okay, once the signal has reached a certain value, a digital circuit, on the other hand, is designed to accept only voltages of a specific given value. A circuit that uses only two states is known as the binary circuit, and circuit designed with binary quantities, say like the on and off, represent one or zero, that is a true or a false, uses the logic of Boolean algebra. So arithmetic is also performed in binary number system employing Boolean algebra. Now, these basic elements are combined in the design of ICs for digital computer and associated devices to perform the desired function. Okay, so the digital circuits are they have a high noise immunity, and analog circuits are sensitive to noise. They have an ease; very easily they pick up crosstalks. Digital circuits are immune to power supply variations, whereas analog circuits are sensitive to power supply variations. And as I said, digital circuits, they carry only one bit of information, whereas since analog is, they're dealing with continuous signals, they carry n bit of information. Okay, so this is the major difference between or why analog circuits are important. Okay, so again, when we are discussing or dealing with analog circuit design, one needs to consider all these points in your mind. So why is analog circuits take an infinitely variable real voltage or current and then modify it to some useful way. So the signal might be amplified, or it may be compared with another signal, or it can also be mixed with other signals, separated from other signals, and examined. It can be also examined for values, or otherwise it can also be manipulated. Further, the design of this circuit, the choice of every individual component, size, placement, connection is very crucial in the analog circuit design. So unique decision bonds, for instance, whether one connection should be slightly wider than the other connection, whether one resistor should be oriented parallel or perpendicular to another, or whether one wire can lay over the top of another. Every small detail affects the final performance of the end product. An analog signal is a time-varying and generally it is bound to a range of, say, for example, minus 12 volt to plus 12 volts. But there is an infinite development. Okay, there is an infinite development in number of values within the continuous range. And analog signal uses this or uses a given property of the medium to convey the signal information. So such as say electricity moving through a wire. So in an electrical signal, the voltages, current and frequency of the signal may be varied to represent the information. So analog signals are often calculated responses to change in light, or it can be sound, temperature, position, pressure, and other physical phenomena. Okay, so if you see the sensor systems, the parameters that they measure can be light or a sound or a temperature or a position or humidity, pressure, like that. Okay, so handling positive and negative signals, okay, is a very important design issue need to be considered when you are designing analog systems. And the second most important parameter is biasing. Okay, so what is biasing? Biasing is setting the initial operating conditions. When I say initial operating condition, it means for the current as well as it means for the voltage of an active device. Okay, say when I say active device, it could be an amplifier circuit. Okay, so the AC signal applied to them is superpositioned on the DC bias current or a voltage, that is called as biasing. So a bias circuit is a portion of the device circuit which supplies a steady current or a voltage. Okay, so that's why biasing is again a very important component in the analog circuit design, because it gives you the stability area, or it represents the flat curve area where there can be less distortions in the information that is carried out. Okay, and then the third important component is linearity. Okay, so linearity is the behavior of a circuit particularly an amplifier in which the output signal strength varies in direct proportion to the input signal. So linearity is one of the most important specifications in electrical circuit. So defining a highly linear analog circuit is always a challenging task, and it is becoming even more difficult with shrinking feature sizes and reducing supply voltage of modern standard CMOS processes. Okay, so and the fourth important parameter is the noise. Okay, signal noise can interfere with both the analog and digital signals, and however, the amount of noise necessary to affect the digital signal is much higher. Conversely, analog signals represent an infinite range of possible values, and noise is always a problem with sensors and other sensitive circuits. To further optimize the noise performance, you can add filters in the feedback path, including a capacitor in parallel with a feedback resistor, lower the gain of higher frequency, thereby reducing the output referred noise. Okay. So lower noise tolerance is always a preferred performance parameter for an analog circuit design. When you're lowering, or I said there can be change, lower drift, okay? Changes in your voltage or changes in your current, okay, can vary, okay, when your temperature varies, or when the component temperature of the components vary, that will have a impact on your current, or it will have an impact on your voltage. Okay, so it is always required to maintain lower drift in case of your analog circuit designs. And again, unavailability of smaller cell size and difficulty in realizing low voltage and low power circuit is again very challenging for the different technologies like CMOS. You're using the CMOS, or you're using the BiCMOS, or you're using the bipolar, right? So it is very difficult. Okay, so these are some of the analog circuit parameters that you have to keep in mind, okay, when you are designing, some of the features that you have to keep in mind when you are designing. Okay, and some of the main parameters in the design of considered in the design of analog circuit is the transconductance. Okay, so it is the transconductance, the output resistance, input referred noise, and the frequency response bandwidth. So these are the primary four components that you need to keep in mind, or parameters to check the performance of the analog circuit designs. Okay, so transconductance of a transistor is defined. So what do we understand by transconductance? So it is nothing but the ratio of a change in collector current to the change in the base voltage, and provided it has a constant collector voltage. Okay, so the resistance across the output terminal of a circuit or a device. So the input and output impedance of an amplifier is what is output resistance? Okay, the output resistance is the input and output impedance or resistance of an amplifier is the ratio of voltage to current flow in or out of the terminal. Okay, so the input impedance may depend again on the source supply feeding the amplifier, while the output impedance or resistance may depend upon the varying load impedance. Okay, that is RL across the output terminal, where the load that is connected across the output terminal. So, and the third important parameter is your input referred noise. So, input referred noise is the noise voltage or the current that, when applied to an input of a noiseless circuit, generates the same output noise as the actual circuit does. Okay, that means the input referred noise is the noise voltage or the current when applied to the input of a noiseless circuit, generates the same output noise as the actual circuit does. Okay, and then you have the fourth important parameter is the frequency response bandwidth. Okay, so I'm sure you know the definition of bandwidth. Bandwidth is a range of frequencies that that a circuit operates in between in between the points of upper and lower cutoff points or frequencies. So these cutoff or corner frequency points indicate the frequency at which the power associated with the output falls to half its maximum value. Okay. So these are the important parameters. What are they? Transconductance, output resistance, input referred noise, and frequency response bandwidth. Now let's see what the expression for the transconductance. Okay, so the transconductance of a transistor, as I said, is defined as or is a measure of how well it is a measure of how well it converts a voltage signal into a current signal. Okay, and it is one of the most important parameter in integrated circuit design. Okay, and the symbol of transconductance is symbolically it is represented as G subscript M, and the unit that we use is the T Siemens. At same unit, the same unit that is used for the direct current conductance. So if D, so if we observe the expression for GM is GM is equal to DIC by DVBE. Okay, DIC by DVBE. Okay, so where DIC represents the change in the collector or the if it is a collector current, if it is a BJT, and or the drain current, if it is a FET. Okay, caused by a small change in the base voltage. Okay, or if it is a BJT or a gate voltage in case of FET. Okay, here if this transistor that I am using is a BJT, then it represents the base voltage. If I am using an FET, then it represents a gate voltage. Okay, so it is a representation of change in the collector current or the drain current caused by a small change in the base or the gate voltage. Okay, and then the transconductance is approximately equal to DIC by DVBE. So as the size of the interval approaches, okay, so as the interval approaches zero, that is the change in the base or the gate voltage, the change in the base or the gate voltage, the smaller the, it becomes smaller and smaller. Okay, so the value of DIC by DVBE approaches a slope. Okay, so this approaches a slope. So you can see the point of intersection here. Okay, so this approaches the slope of a line tangent to the curve at a specific point. Okay, so at a specific point, and the slope of this line represents the theoretical translation. It represents the theoretical transconductance of the bipolar transistor for a given base voltage and collector current. Okay, for a given base voltage and collector current. Okay, and so the symbol G, okay, the symbol G, we are representing transconductance by GM. So the symbol G is used for conductance, and GM value is it is DIC by VBE, which so DIC can also be, or IC collector current would be represented with the expression for the saturation current, that is IC can also be expressed as IS into exponential VBE by VT, or GM can be written rewritten as 1 by VT into IS exponential VBE by VT, or GM can also be represented as IC by VT. Okay, so GM can be visualized as the slope of IC versus VBE curve. Okay, so if you observe the waveform here, okay, and hence the slope increases with IC. Okay, the symbol G is used for conductance because it represents conductance, and the GM value can also be called as the mutual conductance. Okay, that is DIC by DVBE we are talking, right? So this can also be called as the mutual conductance. So its notation is G, and therefore the notation used is GM. Okay, and typically the value of GM for a small signal field effect transistors lie anywhere between 1 to 30 millisiemens. Okay, as I said, the unit used for the transconductance is siemens. Okay, so it can be anywhere. Okay, for a small signal field effect transistor is 1 to 30 millisiemens. Okay. So that is about the transconductance, and now let's have an introduction on the transistors. Okay, so if we recall, okay, if you recall a diode which you have studied in your previous semesters, okay, so what is a diode? So it is a semiconductor device that is developed when two types of semiconductor material, say for example a n-type and a p-type, are joined together, right? And we also know that electrons, that means represented by a negative charge, and a majority are the majority carriers for a n-type material, and for holes it is the positive charges. Hole is represented by a plus, right? Plus or a positive charge, and the holes are again the majority carriers for a p-type material. So transistors are formed when an extra layer, okay, so you already have two you have two layer diode is a two layer device, so for these two layers if you had add an additional layer, okay, then it becomes a three layer device. Okay, so the transistors are formed when an extra layer is added to the p-n junction. Okay, so transistors are the first it was first invented by American physicist named by John Bardeen, okay, in the year 1947. And before the inception of transistor, vacuum tubes were used to control the electronic signals. Okay, and a transistor is a semiconductor device that comes with a three layer, or as I said, it is a three layer device where a small current at one terminal is used to control a current at the other terminal. Okay, that is the small current used at the input terminal to control a current at the output terminal. Okay, so the transistors are mainly used for the amplification of electric signals, and transistors are created with an intention of providing a cheap electronics, and they are also available individually. However, most of the time they are packed together in an integrated circuit, which are then used for development of processors, or it can be for computer memory, chips, complex integrated circuit. So a transistor is a combination of two words. Okay, what is transistor means? It is a combination of two words. That means transfer plus resistor. Okay, or you can also call it as a varistor, transfer plus varistor, where each layer comes with the ability to transfer the current to other layers when a proper biasing voltage is applied across one of the layers. Okay, so transistor comes with three layers, and or I can say two p-n junctions connected back to back. Okay, so two p-n junctions where an emitter base junction is out of the two, one will be forward biased and one will be reverse biased. Say for example, two p-n junctions where the emitter base junction is forward biased and the collector base junction is reverse biased. So most of the transistors are created using either the silicon or the germanium that are less expensive when I compare it to a vacuum tube. And it requires again less power to operate, and based on the mobility of the majority charge carriers. Okay, that is for a n-type the majority carriers are electrons, and for p-type the holes are the majority carriers, right? Okay, so Based on the mobility of the majority charge carriers, transistors are divided into two types, that is an NPN and a PNP transistor. So both are different in terms of the electrical behavior and as well as the physical construction. Okay, so the transistor come in a variety of or say various variety of types, including say the it can be the BJT or it can be the JFET, that is JFET, junction field effect transistors. BJT is bipolar junction transistors, or it can be MOSFETs. Okay, metal oxide semiconductor field effect transistors. Okay. So BJTs are the bipolar junction transistors which use two charge, why it is called bipolar, because it uses two charge carriers, electrons as well as holes for the electrical conduction. And BJTs are the current control devices where a small current at the one terminal is used to control a large current at the other terminal. While JFETs are unipolar devices where conduction is carried out by the movement of only one charge carrier. And transistors are mainly used for the amplification of a low and high frequency AC signals. Okay. So bipolar junction transistors and field effect transistors are and majorly are the three terminal devices. And some of the application areas are where find the application of transistor in analog circuits. Transistors and analog circuits are mainly used in amplifiers, linear regulated power supplies. In digital circuits, they function as electrical switches, including logic gates, random access memory, and microprocessors. Okay. And then let's see each of them individually. The field effect, now let's see the semiconductor device, the field effect transistors. As I said, it is a three terminal device, and initially it was patented by Julius Edgard Lenenfeld in 1926 first, and by Oscar Haley in 1934. And the practical semiconductor device were, that is the JFET devices were developed much later. Okay, and again MOSFET, that is the metal oxide on semiconductor field effect transistors, was invented by Davon Kanag and Martin Atlah in 1960. And MOSFETs largely supersede the JFETs and have a more profound effect on electronic development. So the field effect transistors, or the FET, is a key electronic component usually with, which is used mainly in many areas of electronic industry. So FETs are used in many circuits constructed from discrete electronic components in the area of radio frequency technologies or RF technologies to power control and to electronic switching to general amplifications. However, majorly they are used in integrated circuits. So in the FET circuits consume much lower level of power than the integrated circuits using the BJT, the bipolar transistor technology. Okay. And that's why they're in high demand, or most of your BJTs are now replaced, or FET has taken over the market. Okay. Again, this enables a very large scale integration to operate. And if bipolar technology was used, the power consumption would be of the order of magnitude of greater magnitude, and the power generated was far too large to be dissipate from the integrated circuit. And there are majorly different types of FET devices available. Like you have some of the major categories are junction JFET, okay, junction field effect transistors. Then you also have the insulated gate FETs. Then you have the metal oxide silicon FETs MOSFETs. And then you also have the dual gate MOSFETs. Then you also have MESFET, okay, the metal silicon FET. And then you also have HEMT or PHEMT devices, that is the high electron mobility transfer and pseudomorphic high electron mobility transistors. Then you also have the FinFET devices, okay, FinFET technology, and then you also have the VMOS, that is the vertical MOS technology. Okay, so these are the wide variety of FET devices that are available for the application. And again, when you observe the input-output relationship for a FET device, it exhibits a square law relationship in the region above the threshold voltage, and there is an exponential relationship in the sub-threshold region, okay, where VI is less than VT. We will get into the more details when we are exclusively discussing the transfer characteristics for the MOSFETs, okay. And then now let's see the BJT, the other semiconductor device, which is the bipolar junction transistors, okay. And bipolar junction, as you all already familiar, BJT stands for bipolar junction transistor, and it is a type of transistor that uses both electrons and holes. Why it is called bipolar is because it uses electrons as well as holes as the charge carriers. Okay, so a bipolar junction transistor is also called as a three terminal. Okay, it is a three terminal device, and that can function as an electronic switch for digital circuits and as an amplifier in case of your analog circuits. Okay, and the main basic function of the BJTs are to amplify the current or it is used as a switch to provide wide application in electronic equipments that includes your mobile phones, or it can be industrial control or television, radio, transmitters, okay. And the BJT again enjoyed almost 3 decades, okay, before FET could come. BJT technology almost survived for more than 3 decades as the device of choice in the design of discrete as well as integrated circuits. And there are again 2 types of BJTs available. They are the NPN and the PNP. PNP, okay. So you can see the symbolic representation of NPN transistor and the PNP transistors, okay. And the bipolar junction, again, they are the solid state devices, and the current flow in the two terminals, that is the emitter and the collector, and the flow of current is again controlled by the third terminal, which is the base terminal. Okay, so it is a three terminal device. You have the terminals are emitter, base, and collector. Okay, so the current flow in the emitter and collector in the emitter and the collector terminal is controlled by the base terminal, and it is different from the FET device in the sense that the output current is controlled by the input voltage. Okay, and the basic and if you observe the symbolic representation of the n-type or the p-type devices, you see that the direction of the arrow differs for both of them for the emitter terminal. Okay. So this basically represents the current flow because of charge. You have 2 types of charge carriers, right? So it basically represents the arrow direction will represent the current flow because of the charge carriers, whether it is the whole electrons or whether it is the holes, okay? It represents, so inward arrow represents a PNP transistor, and outward arrow of the emitter represents a NPN transistor. And again, the IVO relationship, okay, the input-output relationship for a BJT is device also exhibits an exponential relationship, okay. And what is the present status of these semiconductor devices? So discrete, as I said, discrete MOSFETs are not available commercially because of the problems associated with the electric or the electrostatic discharges. And again, JFET, that is the junction field effect transistors, are available, but their use is not so popular in signal processing. Okay, and then you have the MOSFET technology, again, is dominant in both digital and analog integrated circuits. And then you have the BJTs were commercially made available for several decades, and their usage at present in signal processing function has practically reduced considerably, for the fact that power and speed are the main focus for the design of the latest wireless systems or portable devices, right? And that's why that is the reason. Okay, and if we talk about the integrated device technology, integrated circuit. So what do we understand by integrated circuit? So integrated circuit is, we can also call them as the microelectronic circuits or the microchips or the chip, and which is an assembly of electronic components fabricated as a single unit, in which miniaturization of active devices, it can be the transistors or it can be the diodes, and passive devices with capacitor and resistor, and their interconnection are built up on a thin substrate of semiconductor material, okay, which is typically silicon, okay, and the resulting circuit is thus a small monolithic chip, which may be as small as a few centimeter or only a few square millimeter. The individual circuit component are generally microscopic in size, and the integrated circuit have their origin in the invention of transistor way back in 1947 by William Shockley. Okay, and his team at the American Telephone and Telegraph Company, that is the Bell's Laboratory. Okay, and again in IE integrated circuits, you have based on, I mean, you have different configurations, okay, or different varieties available, like the application specific integrated circuits that can be ASIC, we call it as ASIC, can be either for a digital or an analog circuit. And then you have, and again, ASICs are not reconfigurable. Okay, they perform only at specific functions, okay, or they are application oriented. And then you have the say, for example, speed control controller IC for a remote control car is hardwired to do one job, and it could never become a microprocessor. Okay, and then ASIC does not contain an ability to follow alternate instructions. Okay. And then you have the radio in frequency integrated circuits, RFICs, okay, which are widely used in mobile phones and wireless devices. And RFICs are analog circuits that usually run in frequency range of 3 kilohertz to 2.4 gigahertz. That is 3,000 hertz to say 2.4 billion hertz. And circuits that would work at about 1 terahertz, say 1 trillion hertz, is being also developed. And then you have the monolithic microwave ICs. Okay, a special type of RFICs is known as the monolithic microwave ICs, and or we call it as the MMIC, which is called as the microwave monolithic ICs. And these circuits are usually run in the range of 2 to 100 gigahertz, or say microwave frequency, and are used in radio, radar systems, and in satellite systems, and as power amplifiers in cellular telephones. Okay, so all of these integrated circuit devices use the technology. Predominantly, they use the CMOS technology, that is the complementary MOS technology, and the bi-complementary, that is bi-CMOS technology, that is bipolar and complementary MOSFET technology to a limited extent. And all digital integrated circuits are manufactured using mostly the CMOS, as I said, and some mixed signal circuits are made up with the bipolar and complementary MOSFET technology. And some of the operational amplifiers based on bipolar devices are still produced today because of their popularity with the users. Okay. So here I would like to end my session for session one of the module one of the course Analog Electronics. I hope you were able to understand what is the importance of analog circuit design is required and what are the different technologies available in the present day, what is the present day demand. Okay, so let's meet in the second session to go get in-depth knowledge on the different biasing approach for the BJTs. Thank you.